Let's go ahead and get started here. Like you guys are in the dark. This week in lab, you're doing experiment 12 and 13. Experiment 12 is most of your pre-lab because that's the experiment we're doing. Experiment 13 has to do with TLC, so I'll talk about that here in a little bit. But most of your pre-lab is going to come from 12. Maybe a little bit of like drawings can come from experiment 13 of new equipment. You'll have a quiz this week, so make sure you're ready for that. Your experiment 8 and 11 report is due next week, so check in with your lab prof as to when that is. So we'll talk about here in a minute. We don't have lab next week because of Thanksgiving. So find out exactly when your report is due, okay? And that's 2 experiments, so it's 75 points. So remember to get all the points you can for that one. Get your GC data from your lab prof. All of the GC samples that were prepared last week have been run, and all that data has been collected. So your lab prof now has that data. I've handed it off to them. So somehow they will be getting it to you. Now we're starting to look at finals week, because the next time I see you, I will actually be giving you the practice exam for the final exam. Okay, so here's your first reminder for final exam. It is Tuesday, December 12th from 3 to 5 p.m. in Vanderworth 102, okay, here. So on Tuesday of final exam week at 3 o'clock, so in the 3 o'clock exam time, which is the exam time for the Monday at 4 p.m. lecture, your exam is in here. Everybody, all lab sections together, we'll get together, so make sure that's on your calendar. So next week we won't have lab because we don't have, you know, Thanksgiving. We're not going to have you come to lab on Thanksgiving. So we're not going to have lab on Tuesday either, okay? So for open lab next week, Monday it's just regular 9:30 a.m. to 3:30 p.m. But there's no lab lecture, okay, because there's no lab next week. So you can get a break at 4 o'clock next Monday. Tuesday, we'll have open lab like we did on the Thursday of fall break week, except for it's on Tuesday this time. So from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. next Tuesday, so not tomorrow Tuesday, but a week from Tuesday, the 21st, we'll have lab open for you to come in at any point during 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. to work, okay? And then Wednesday, the day before Thanksgiving, so the 22nd, we'll have open lab over at 9:30, but we're going to close it at 12 so the stockroom people can get home for Thanksgiving as well, okay? All right, couple notes about experiment 8 and 11 GC data before we start talking about this week's lecture. So you should get your standards from your lab prof. All right, so they should somehow have either printed them for you, emailed them to you, put it on their Moodle site, but make sure you get them from your lab prof. There was a little bit of variation between the Tuesday standards and the Thursday standards, so make sure you get the correct standards from your lab prof. So you want to account for all the peaks in your GC data, okay? So don't just ignore peaks. You need to label them as something, all right? So start with the standards, see what you can figure out just based on the standard retention times, and then go from there as far as labeling the rest of the peaks. If you can't label something as something, then call it an unknown, but just be careful in doing so, okay? So things to remember for every trans alkene, there's a cis one in there somewhere, okay? You're not going to just have a trans without a cis. Think about the positional isomers you should have made. They should be in there, so you should be able to somehow account for them, okay? Also think about with the alcohol GC, there potentially could have been ketone in there. There could still be alcohol and ketone in your alkene GC as well. So start with the standards, label what you can, and then be really careful going through what you think you can't label and make sure it's absolutely unknown before you label it as an unknown, all right? So like heptenes were around 2 minutes, 2+ minutes, octanes, 4+ minutes. Heptanones, so the ketone of the heptanols were about 6.5 to 7 minutes. The heptanols are about 7 minutes. And the octanones are about 8.5 to 9 minutes, so a little before the octanols that are in the 9 minute range, okay? So just keep that all in mind, and then keep in mind the table that is in experiment 10 that you want to use to present your GC data in your lab notebook, all right? So I believe that's table 10.2. Here, I'll give it to you real quick. It is table 10.2 on page 10-11. So there's an example table, like what you want for each set of your GC data. Okay, so you want one table for 8 and one table for 11. You want both sets of data in separate tables, okay? The other thing with the GC data is any data like that, you don't usually want to cut, trim, make smaller to fit in your notebook, anything like that, because if you are changing the data in any way, it looks like maybe you are cutting away something that should be important or something like that. So we know what your data should look like, and if you've trimmed your data, we know you probably just trimmed it to fit in your notebook. But anywhere beyond here, a notebook, it would be speculated, okay, why is this data cut up? What is missing from the data? So what you don't want to do is don't cut up your data, don't trim your data. You want both the peak list and the chromatogram in your notebook for both sets of data, okay? And so don't try and cut and piece things together to make things fit in there better. You're going to put all of the pages in your notebook, all right? So any questions on that at all before I go on to experiment 12? Okay, so experiment 12, we are going to look at the Diels-Alder reaction. So has anyone covered that in lecture? They thought maybe not, not yet?
Not there yet, okay.
Well, here is your preview for what is coming in lecture. So when they get to dienes, they're going to cover the Diels-Alder reaction, which is what we are doing in lab this week. So the Diels-Alder reaction is a reaction between a diene and a dienophile, okay? And it happens, so if we have our, here, and here's more pictures of it here too, okay? So I'm not going to go in as much detail as they're going to go into about the Diels-Alder reaction because we've also got to cover TLC. But I'm going to give you some general here, okay? So typically, you'll label the carbons that are involved in this way. Oops, backwards. Make sure it's the same as what's in your manual, or that's not very helpful, okay? And so basically, what happens with a Diels-Alder reaction is it's really nice. It all happens in one step, and basically you rearrange all the electrons and you get a ring out of it, okay? And what's really great about it is you get, for one reaction, so it was great in the Grignard reaction where we got one carbon-carbon bond formation. Diels-Alder reaction, you get two. And it all happens in one step, and you conserve the stereochemistry. You get a nice ring out of it. It's a wonderful reaction. And you don't really even have any byproducts out of the deal either. So if you can set it up to have a nice Diels-Alder reaction, it's a great thing to use. So what happens is we basically have our electrons just kind of rearranging themselves as we go around the ring. So that's what's shown up in this first part here. We just have this cyclic rearrangement of the electrons, and then in the end, we end up with a six-membered ring. Okay? I want to draw an aromatic ring whenever I see a six-membered ring, but nope. We get out of our three double bonds, we get a ring and one double bond left, okay? Now, our butadiene and our ethylene, not the greatest reactants for this, okay? We could probably use our butadiene, but definitely our ethylene is not super reactive. So in a little bit here, I'm going to talk to you about what we do to make these more reactive, what makes a better Diels Alder reaction. But this is the basics that's involved. So it's a 4 plus 2 cyclo addition. Here's our 4 plus our 2. We made a ring, so that's our cyclo addition, all right? So there's a lot of adjectives we can use with the Diels Alder reaction besides 4 plus 2 cyclo addition. It is called, it's a concerted reaction or a concerted mechanism because it happens all in one step. Okay? So we don't isolate any intermediates. You're just going to put your reactants together, and in one step you would have your product. The other thing is it's also called a pericyclic reaction or mechanism. And that means that we have a cyclic transition state. So we kind of have this transition state when we're rearranging our electrons. We kind of have the transition state here. This would be our cyclic transition state of the two pieces coming together, all right? And the other thing that is nice with this one, we don't have to worry, this is not a polar mechanism, so it's not polar. We don't have any radicals involved, so it's different from the mechanisms we've looked at previously. And basically what's really important is you put together the proper reagents to make it happen, and then you can make the reaction happen, okay? So for the dienophile, so actually, sorry, we'll do dienophile first, then we'll talk about the dienophile. So that meaning that it wants to react with the diene. The diene has, you know, two alkenes there, okay? Two double bonds for it to react with. So we got to do something here to make it want to react with that electron density, okay? And so what you want to use are electron withdrawing groups on your dienophile so that it'll want to have some of that electron density that the diene can contribute to it, okay? And so things like our ethylene, not so reactive, but you put things like make it have an aldehyde on it. So if we had something like this, then we've got an electron withdrawing group on it that makes it more reactive. Or if we put an ester on it. These two are going to be more reactive than just plain old ethylene, okay? So you want electron withdrawing groups on your dienophile. The diene, what we use is what's called an S-cis conformation. And so we take that conformation, like what I've shown with butadiene here. You want this conformation of your diene, so it's coming together to react with what you've got for your dienophile, okay? So the two can come together. Because if you have this, that's not going to react as easily with the dienophile if it's in the wrong conformation. So if you don't want this, that is what you want, is the S cis. So that's really important for the diene itself, okay? And what you need is carbon 1 and carbon 4 close enough to your dienophile to react. The other thing that happens, and it's kind of shown here, and I'll show you here in a minute with stereochemistry too. Basically, so when you cover this in lecture, they're going to talk about probably going to talk about HOMO and LUMO, p orbitals, and the reaction of where the electrons are and where they're reacting. But basically, you've got this p orbital overlap because you've got these double bonds, okay? And that's what's coming together for the reaction. So what you want to do is get maximum orbital overlap. So you want your dienophile and diene to come together so they can overlap as much as possible. What you don't want is this mismatch like this, because you won't really get a good reaction that way, okay? So you want them to come together like this. So because of that, what you form is what's called an endo product versus an exo product, okay? So this reaction here, if we show maleic anhydride coming together with cyclopentadiene, okay, it is going to form this product, the endo product. And that was because we got maximum orbital overlap of the 1 and 4 carbon coming together with that dienophile, okay? It does not form the exo product, so it does not want to react like this. It wants to react like this, okay? So key for remembering right now is endo product is what you form. You don't form the exo product, okay? And that is because you want to maximize that orbital overlap, okay? So I'll put that over here too. We get the endo product. And because this is set, you conserve your stereochemistry too. So that's kind of shown here, this example. Down here. So if you've got butadiene, and then this dienophile, this diester, the electron withdrawing groups are two esters on your dienophile, okay? The reaction of this is going to conserve, you've conserved the stereochemistry around your dienophile, okay? So you're not going to get a bunch of different possibilities for products. You're going to get this set of products, okay? And that has to do with that orbital overlap being set, what is going to happen, all right? So for our own reaction, we've got N-phenylmalamide reacting with cyclopentadiene. So here's our diene, here's our dienophile. We actually have two electron withdrawing groups. So even though the dienophile is one ring, each of these groups count as two electron withdrawing groups. So that makes it a really good dienophile to react with the cyclopentadiene. Okay. So this week, with your reaction, we're going to talk about how you're going to monitor your reaction with TLC. But the actual heating of your reaction is all of 10 minutes. That's all you need to get the reaction to go. Okay. And even probably before you start heating it that 10 minutes, you're going to start seeing signs of reaction, all right? So these two reactants are super reactive together, okay? And so just like the example I showed, we've got this cyclic rearrangement of electrons. So from between 5 and 6 to 1, between 1 and 2 to between 2 and 3, from 3 to 4 over to 5, we then formed this ring here. So here and here are the new bonds that were made, okay? And this is from this bridge here of the cyclopentadiene, okay? And then again, we got our endo product. That is what's formed. So this is what your final product is going to look like this week, okay? Now, what we have to do for getting the cyclopentadiene, you can't just buy cyclopentadiene in the bottle, okay? Because it happens that cyclopentadiene is a really great diene. It's also a really great dienophile for itself. So what you buy is dicyclopentadiene because it likes being the Diels-Alder product, okay? Okay, so if you take two cyclopentadienes, they can react together to give you dicyclopentadiene. And so that's what happens. So what we've got to do is what's called cracking the dicyclopentadiene to get to your cyclopentadiene. So we've got to heat it and distill the cyclopentadiene right before you're going to use it so that it will react in your reaction, all right? So this week in the labs, before the labs start, I'm gonna, right before they start, be cracking the cyclopentadiene so that it's fresh for you to use this week. And so your lab prof or potentially your TA is gonna dispense of it, because even once we crack it, we've gotta keep it on ice, we've gotta keep it really cold, so it doesn't react on us before you get to put it into your reaction, all right? So we'll dispense of that for you, okay? So a couple things for experiment 12 before I start talking about before we look at TLC and experiment 13, okay? So in a minute here, when we talk about experiment 13 and TLC plates, I'm gonna tell you there's gonna be points where you're gonna have to spot a TLC plate, okay? So beyond what I give you here, also keep in mind you're also going to be working with TLC plates. But your reaction this week, basically you're going to get the two reactants together, you'll have to spot your TLC plate, and then you're gonna put the reflux together, reflux it for 10 minutes, okay? Then you're going to cool everything down. So your reaction solvent is ethyl acetate. You need to remove the ethyl acetate to get your product to precipitate out, okay? So basically you're gonna have reflux for the reaction. Then you're going to need to distill that ethyl acetate, okay? And so that's also known as we're doing a solvent exchange. We're changing out the solvent, so we're going to get rid of the ethyl acetate. We're going to add in hexane, and your solid will precipitate out with hexane, okay? So you're going to want to precipitate your product with hexane. And then you're going to recrystallize that product with ethanol. And you'll use a little bit of water to help it as well, okay? So really there's not a ton of steps in the isolation of your product and having your final product in hand, okay? A lot of what you're going to work on this week is the TLC part, but for that final product, you want to make sure, as always, you want to collect yield. You may have to wait for this to dry because you're recrystallizing from ethanol and there'll be a little bit of water in there, so it may need to dry for you before you collect this yield, so you may have to come to open lab to do this. You're going to need to collect a melting point. Now, this melting point, there is not a standard for you to compare it to, okay? So you're just collecting the melting point of that product. And at the end of the day, I'm gonna give you what the melting point range should be. So you'll have a known range of what it should be. You're going to collect the melting point, which probably will be, again, maybe an open lab. And then you'll need to collect the IR spectrum, okay? On Moodle, I am going to post for you, there's going to be standards of the starting materials, so as best we can, cyclopentadiene or dicyclopentadiene, whatever it ended up with by the time we put it on the IR, okay? The N-phenylmalamine, and then the final product. So there's three IR spectra that I am going to post for you that you're going to compare your IR spectrum to, okay? And then you'll collect the IR spectrum of your solid. It's a solid, so it'll be like what you did for experiment 7, collecting experiment 7 IR, okay? And then the last part is, and we'll talk about that here in a second, is then the TLC analysis. and that's going to happen during the reaction, and then also you will be spotting your, making a solution of your final product to spot on the TLC plate as well, okay? So questions with this at all? Okay, this up here for you guys to have for a little bit. So experiment 13, another chromatography, the last one for the semester. This time it's thin layer chromatography. So just like all the others, we have to have an acronym. That's TLC for this one, okay? And just like with the other chromatographies, we always have a mobile phase and we always have a stationary phase. So your stationary phase. It is silica that is on a plastic backing and it's on a plate, okay? So we call it a TLC plate. So the silica on that plate is your stationary phase. Your mobile phase is the eluent or the solvent that you use to develop the TLC plate in, okay? And so what is happening here with this mobile phase and the stationary phase is there's an equilibrium. And what you spot on that TLC plate is going between the stationary phase and the mobile phase. It's going back and forth as it, that eluent is traveling up the TLC plate, okay? And so it's this partitioning back and forth between the stationary phase and the mobile phase, but kind of like you did with like a liquid-liquid extraction where you had the two phases mixing together. Instead of it happening once though, so you shake it up, they mix, and then they separate it, this is happening a bunch of times going back and forth as that solvent travels up the TLC plate, okay? Now, what comes into play here is the polarity of the compounds or compound that you're looking at on the TLC plate, okay? So the stationary phase, the silica, is fairly polar. So if you have polar compounds, they're gonna wanna hang out with the stationary phase more than they're gonna wanna hang out with the eluent, all right? So they won't go as high up a TLC plate, okay? If you have more nonpolar compounds, they'll hang out more with the eluent than they will with the stationary phase, so they will travel higher up the TLC plate, okay? So let's look at first kind of what the plates that we're talking about developing chamber, and then we'll look more into what actually is happening on the TLC plate, okay? So here is a drawing of a TLC plate, all right? So it's a rectangle. The TLC plates that you guys are going to use in lab, we even have given you, we've cut the plates for you, so that's not always a given, okay? So the fact they're already cut for you. And we've already drawn a line on the bottom of them so you know what line to spot on, okay? But you're going to use spotters that we're going to teach you how to make out of little capillaries and spot your solutions on the bottom of the TLC plate. And then what you do is you put it in a developing chamber that has developing solvent in it, okay, and some filter paper. So what you want to do is put your, this is your eluent, this is your mobile phase. You put that in your chamber first. You let it all climb up, or you let the eluent climb up the filter paper. So then basically, that's getting your chamber at equilibrium as far as the solvent is concerned. And then you're going to put your TLC plate in that chamber. And what you want is you don't want the eluent going above that line where you spot it, okay? So you want it to stay below it and then travel up the plate. And so while the eluent's traveling up the plate, that's where this equilibrium is happening back and forth between the mobile phase and the stationary phase. And so on a plate, this is kind of a representation of a plate you will get in lab. It'll be a rectangle with silica, plastic backing. It's going to have a pencil line drawn on the bottom. Okay. So then you're going to spot the solutions you want to spot on that baseline. Okay. And this is the line. You don't want the eluent. You want the eluent to be below it when you stick it in the chamber, and then you want it to climb up beyond that line, up to usually about a centimeter or so from the top of the TLC plate. Okay. Then you're going to, when it gets up to about a centimeter or so from the top of the TLC plate, you pull it out of the TLC plate, out of the developing chamber, and you mark that line that the solvent went to with pencil, okay? Now with TLC plates, you have to be really careful, because what we're looking at with these is we're looking at UV active material, all right? So we're gonna use UV lamps to be able to see what is, that's how we visualize what's going on with the TLC plates in our case. There's other ways to do it, but for this lab, we're using the UV lights, okay? So there's a dye that's on the TLC plate that helps you be able to see UV active material. Thing to consider though is in your hands, there's lots of UV active material with all of your amino acids, proteins, all of that in your hands, okay? So you don't want to handle, like you don't want to stick your hand on the TLC plate. You don't want to, you know, grab it from front and back. You want to handle it from the sides and wear gloves so you don't get, if you touch it with your fingerprints when you go to develop it, you'll see fingerprints all over it, okay? And you won't be able to see what you want to see. The other thing is we use pencil, not pin, for any of the marking on the TLC plate, because it's got plenty of compounds in it that would travel up with the eluent and be UV active and mark up the TLC plate too, okay? So you have to use pencil on TLC plates. The one thing you have to be careful of with pencil, though, is you don't want a super sharp pencil. You actually want kind of a dull pencil, because it's really easy to break apart the silica when you're drawing on it and marking where you've spotted, and eventually you're going to draw where the spots are once you develop it. It's really easy to carve into the silica when you're drawing it or drawing where your solvent line went. Okay, so be really careful with marking it, that you don't carve, you don't want to carve out the silica, you just want to mark on the silica, okay? So back to what I was talking about, polarity, okay? So in this equilibrium, if we had a polar compound and a non-polar compound that were spotted on here, okay? And this is what it looked like after we developed it. Which would be the polar compound, A or B? A is going to be the polar compound, right? It's not going to travel, the polar compounds don't travel as quickly up the plate as the non-polar compounds, okay? So the non-polar compound would be B. Now when you're thinking about this, okay, you can change the polarity of a solvent, okay? So usually we use a solvent mixture. So like this week you guys are using ethyl acetate and hexane for your eluent. So you usually use something that's relatively nonpolar, the hexane, and something that's got a little bit of polarity to it, so the ethyl acetate, all right? So you could modify that solvent and make it more polar. If you did that, spot A and B would travel farther up the plate. But what you're not going to do is you're not going to flip polarity, okay? So what you're not going to do is make your eluent, you can't make it more polar than the silica, all right? So you're not going to change this trend. You can make the spots travel up farther, but you're still going to have this trend in the polarity, okay? So say you decided to make, instead of 1:1 ethyl acetate, you decided to make your solvent like 5:1 ethyl acetate to hexane. So there's a lot of ethyl acetate in there, okay? What you would do is then raise how far the spots would travel up the plate but you're not changing the relative distance and you're not flipping any polarity. Okay, does everybody see that? Okay. So what you're going to use TLC for this week is you're going to look at your reaction and how it progresses, all right? So you're gonna have standards for your starting material and your product, okay? So the malamide and then your final product. And you're going to be looking at what happens to that reaction mixture. So say we've got this TLC plate at time zero. So this is right after you've gotten the cyclopentadiene added to your TLC plate, which is what is going to happen this week. You're gonna get in your round bottom flask, your ethyl acetate, your malamide, and then once you have it dissolved in the ethyl acetate, then you are going to have your cyclopentadiene added and then spot the TLC plate, okay? Now one caution about that, when you go to get your cyclopentadiene, make sure the solid is dissolved. If it didn't dissolve, most likely you used the hexane ethyl acetate, which is also in the reagent hood. So there's ethyl acetate to set up your reaction. There's hexane ethyl acetate that is your eluent, all right? So if you can't get your solid to dissolve, most likely use the hexane ethyl acetate, not just the regular ethyl acetate, okay? So read labels carefully, all right? But here we've got our starting of our reaction. So we have spotted the reaction. We have lane A is the reactant, lane B is our reaction, lane C is the product. So at time zero, we don't really have any product form. We have reactant in our reaction. Does everyone see that? Because of the relative height that the spots travel, they're going to correspond. And we'll talk about in a minute here how you describe that distance, okay? Then at like, and we're not going 30 minutes, but this reaction went 30 minutes, okay? So at time 30, we've got our reactant standard, our product standard, but our reaction now is between a little bit of reactant and a little bit of product. So you see progress of the reaction. The reaction is progressing towards product, right? Then at the end of, towards the end of the reaction, 45 minutes, reactant, product, our reaction, there's very little reactant left and a lot of product in it. And then at the very end, at 55 minutes, there's no reactant left. There's only product left in that middle lane. Does everyone see how that works? Okay. So what you are comparing with that is what is called the RF value, okay? And so the RF value is this equation here, the distance from origin traveled by the compound divided by the distance from origin traveled by the solvent. So if we have our TLC plate here, okay, our RF is going to be this distance, okay, so whatever this distance is, divided by this distance. So it's the distance traveled by the spot from the origin, and usually measure it from the center, divided by the distance traveled from the eluent from the origin. So that's why you mark how far the eluent gets to the top of the TLC plate, okay? All right, so in our example, it'd be this distance divided by this distance, okay? You're usually measuring this in centimeters, so this isn't really to scale, but let's just play that this is 1 centimeter to 2 centimeters, so our RF is a decimal of 0.5. Now, in reporting an RF value this way, is this ever going to be greater than 1, your RF value? No, right? You're not going to have an RF value greater than 1, because you're always going to have, this number should always be smaller than this number, okay? So you're always looking at a decimal. You're measuring it in the same units, so there's no units on the RF value either. Okay. So back to that reaction, when we're comparing our reactants and products to what's happening with the reaction, we're going to be comparing RF values, okay? So this spot in lane A and this spot in lane B should have the same RF values, because that's what they appear to have, and so when you calculate them, they should have pretty close to the same RF values because they're the same thing. Then when you get down here to where you have all product, this spot and this spot should have pretty much the same RF values, okay, because it's product and product. So for a given system, okay, so the given eluent that you are, specific eluent mixture you are using here, being a given system or a given system over there, you can kind of make a comparison of RF values, all right? But the eluent has to stay the same. As soon as you change the eluent, your RF values are going to change because you've changed the polarity of the solvent. Okay? Everyone good with that so far? Okay. So let's look at a couple of examples here before we I talk to you about what you are going to spot, okay? First of all, which spot is more polar in this example? Which is the more polar compound, okay? B is our more polar compound, all right? A is our less polar compound. Okay, say I've got a one-to-one hexane ethyl acetate mixture is how I developed this TLC plate, all right? If I change the solvent to 4-to-1, hexane ethyl acetate, what is going to happen to the RF values of these spots? So 1-to-1 to 4-to-1 hexane. So first of all, if you go from 1-to-1 ethyl acetate to hexane to 4-to-1 hexane ethyl acetate, is that more polar or less polar? Less polar solvent. So what should happen to the RF values of these spots? Should go down, right? Because you've made the solid less polar, these spots are going to travel less far, okay? So if we went from here to here, we might end up with something like that when we change the solvent like that, okay? You make the solvent less polar, your RF values are going to decrease. If you made the solvent more polar, then your RF values would increase. So saying we went from 1-to-1 here to 4-to-1 ethyl acetate to hexane, then we would have something like that, where the spots have much greater RF values. Right? Everyone good with that? So with TLC, you're always looking at, you're making a comparison of polarity of the compound and whether or not it wants to hang out more with the stationary phase or more with the mobile phase because of the polarity, okay? And then like in this example, remember here would be our denominator for RF value. If we wanted to calculate the RF of spot B, this would be the top number. So distance from here to here would be our top number. This would be our bottom number. Okay, so calculating RF value, okay? All right. So for lab this week, we've got standards that you're going to use, okay? So usually your lab prof is going to have you spot with the reactant standard and the product standard. You usually spot with those on the outside. And you want to make sure, don't spot like right on the edge of the plate because they'll literally fall off your plate, okay? So you need to have like about a half centimeter difference in here and a half centimeter in between your spots too, okay? So then you're going to spot your TLC plate, at the start of the reaction, that's time zero. You're probably going to spot your reaction at 10 minutes, so that's after reflux. So they may have you put that on the same plate or on different plates, okay? And then at the very least, you will also spot your final product, all right? Now your final product is a solid. You can only spot solutions, so you can't even spot like a neat liquid on TLC because that'll make too big a spot. You need a dilute solution of what you are trying to analyze, okay? So your product is soluble in ethyl acetate. You know that because that is what you removed so you could get it to precipitate out, okay? In the labs, there's red cans of ethyl acetate. Use a little bit of that ethyl acetate to dissolve your final product to then be able to spot it for this last TLC plate, okay? Now, when you record TLC plates, they always go in your notebook vertically. You always look at a TLC plate up and down. You don't look at it sideways, okay? You always look at it up and down. You can either copy your TLC plates into your notebook, and then when you're done with them, you dispose of them. So you would copy a life-size drawing, what it looks like, you know, probably even trace the TLC plate, and then draw on it what it looks like with the right RF values, you know, whatever they ended up being, okay, like this. And then make sure you've calculated these numbers, okay? Once you are done drawing it into your notebook, then you could either put it in a paper towel and leave it in your drawer or get rid of it in glass waste. Otherwise, the other option is your lab prof may have you tape the TLC plate into your notebook, in which case you would tape it in vertically, okay? Same thing. So you always look at them vertically. You don't look at TLC plates horizontally. Even if you're running out of room on the bottom of the page and you're trying to squeeze it in, flip the page over and put it on a new page because you look at TLC plates vertically, okay? So any questions on this before I show you couple other things here. And we will tell you specifically in lab which TLC plates to develop, all right? So experiment 12 has worksheets like experiment 6 did. So on the first page, you're going to fill out the top information, draw the structure of the experiment 12 product. Everyone should have the same structure because you're making the same product, right? Then what you're going to do is you're going to record what happened with your TLC plates. So first you want to tell what spot A is. So is spot A a reactant standard, product standard, reaction at time zero, reaction at 10 minutes, crude product, final product, what is that spot? And then give the RF values for all the spots that are in that lane. So if you have one spot, you have one RF value. If you have multiple spots, you have multiple RF values. Okay. Does everyone understand that? Now, one thing with TLC and RF values. So RF values are not like melting points. So every year I'll get someone trying to describe to me the spots in their RF values and the RF value being a little bit less because it was impure. Okay. You don't change the RF value because of impurities. If you have impurities and they're UV active, you will see them on the TLC plate. You will see additional spots, okay? So if you have more than one spot in a lane, it's not pure. If you have one spot in a lane, it's pure as best you can tell by TLC. So you have to put the disclaimer on it, it's pure by TLC, all right? And all we are able to see with this experiment is UV active material. So if there's something on there that's not UV active, then we're not going to see it, okay? But one spot means it's pure, and RF values do not change based on impurities. They will stay the same. You will see more spots if it's impure. Everyone good with that? Okay. So you're going to record all this information for however many spots you use, or TLC plates you use. So if you only have two plates, don't worry about the third. If you have all three plates, then go ahead and record it for however many plates you have. Okay? Then you're going to compare your IR data, and you want to compare it to what is posted on Moodle, and then also make sure you're comparing it to the starting materials. Okay, so you have your IR table to do that, and then you're going to write a page or so conclusion. So your lab prof will give you the specifics for this. Okay, so that's a worksheet in your lab manual. The final thing that you need is information about your product, because it's not something you can look up in Aldrich, all right? So we're making a unique product that is not something that's in the Aldrich catalog. So I'm helping you out because I'm giving you cyclopentadiene information and phenomalamine information. And then this is your product. So the melting point range that you need, besides knowing its molecular weight and its formula, is 144 degrees C. That's the melting point you're going to compare to your own melting point range. How close your melting point range is to that. Okay? So I'll get it all the way for you to copy that. Just make sure in copying it, you can see all of it. You don't get in the way of someone who's writing it down. Okay?
I'll go.